Welcome to the lecture on Enlightenment and its critics. It's going to be a shared lecture. I'll speak for the first 30 minutes, and then Dr. Fugate will take it from there. So I kind of want to begin with a more of a polemical introduction to the topic of Enlightenment. I want to suggest to you today that the stakes are quite high for how we interpret Enlightenment. For it is a social and intellectual phenomenon that introduced what one would call dangerous new forms of thought that threatened the basic structures of authority, tradition, faith, and privilege on which the ancien regime society rested. So this said, Enlightenment, as you will see in your reading selections, was already a project that was originally split into two camps. A radical camp, which insisted on the separation of faith and reason, in which I would place someone like Rousseau, Condorcet, Kant, in line with Spinoza, Diderot, Hegel, and perhaps Marx on this side, and a more moderate or conservative camp, which attempted to reconcile faith and reason in support of a modernized monarchy or an ecclesiastical authority, in which we could place Hobbes, Locke, Bacon, Voltaire, and Hume. So, the radical Enlightenment would be the interest that I want to pursue in this lecture. And the midwife of radical Enlightenment essentially came from philosophy, or what was called l'esprit philosophique. Philosophy provided the pamphleteers, journalists, elected deputies of American, French, Dutch, Italian, and other revolutions of 1770, 1780, and 1790 with slogans, maxims, and ideologies in order to justify a fundamental break with the past. And it was in turn affected by these social transformations. So the overthrow of altar, throne, and nobility was the aim that could only stem from the transformation in the people's way of thinking. Ultimately, Enlightenment, or radical Enlightenment, posited a fundamental link between the transformation or the revolution of the mind, of thought, and of thinking, and political revolution. And as you will see in both Kant and Condorcet's texts, radical Enlightenment takes the stance of affirming intellectual discovery as a salutary pursuit rather than as some kind of calamitous act. So I begin with a question. If Enlightenment indeed aims at disenchanting the world and shattering the great chain of being, is this really reducible to a calamitous result? In other words, what is it in Enlightenment thought that remains essential for our historical present? So it's important also to note from the very beginning that Enlightenment universals or Enlightenment universal propositions were essentially premised on fissures, on breaks, on splits. So thought, as you saw with Descartes, is only possible through radical doubt. Cogito and madness are intertwined. Descartes' obsession, how can I tell the difference between hallucination and thinking? Rationality can only be practiced through a recognition of its very limits with Kant. As we will see today, freedom and autonomy can only be achieved through a heteronomous act of recognizing the law, which would be, you know, when maybe we'll come to this today as well, the categorical imperative as a heteronomous in as far as it's a recognition of a law or a standard that is external to the self, outside the self. Again, another fissure or break is the subject is only human because of language, which in turn proves impossible to turn into a science, a matter that figures ranging from Condillac to Herder to Diderot were considering. And ironically, the Enlightenment that proposes itself as the rebirth of humankind closes with Hegel's declarations of the end of history, the end of philosophy, and the end of art. So, but let's look a bit more closely at the historical context and some of the redefining radical Enlightenment propositions, as I'm calling them. So although the question of what is Enlightenment was raised in German circles, the ideas circulating at the time heavily influenced the French Revolution and were indeed influenced by it. The political and philosophical formulations put forth under the rubric of Enlightenment, or specifically the radical Enlightenment strain, reacted to feudalism and absolutist monarchy and pivoted around exploring the relations between public discussion, religious faith, and political authority. So even though Enlightenment was a European phenomenon, it should not be reduced to a claim for the superiority and integrity of European values. Rather, Enlightenment, as we will see with Kant and Condorcet, is not reducible to any identity position, Western, European, or other. It's not reducible to a subjective position. Enlightenment is precisely about relating negatively to oneself for the purpose of an openness to all others, that I will also suggest to you is not the kind of liberal understanding of the openness to all others. So in a sense, enlightenment posits a certain cut, an irreducible divide within particular positions. It is, as Kant will tell us, about the participation in a universal ethico-political principle that is accessible to everyone. In other words, it is a demand for universality and a transcendence of particularities. Or, as one could perhaps put it, it's about accepting homelessness as the truest of all faiths. So some of the key figures of Enlightenment thought emerge from within the German context in Europe, but were influential for the French and American revolutions. In the course of the 17th and 18th centuries, Europe witnessed the rise of a modern bourgeois society, which, although released man from the fetters of feudalism, chained him into an image of the natural and social worlds as machines made of parts, and in which the individual served as a cog in the machine. The naturalization of a mechanical understanding of the world, as we saw, for instance, exemplified in Francis Bacon's works that we have read, and the fixed laws that were revealed to govern the solar system since Copernicus, once projected onto human society in, let's say, the ideas of the Leviathan, the Hobbesian and Lockean social contracts, and Smithian political economy, proved to be highly problematic. Immanuel Kant describes this mechanization of the social world as a state in which, quote, immaturity has become natural, end of quote, to man. Or dotage was the word that was originally the translation of the word, and in which only rules and formulas epitomize the use of reason and suppress its potentials to free man. This does not mean, however, that Kant did not recognize the real machine-like attributes of man. He realized that indeed, both at two terms that you will look at, perhaps the phenomenal and the noumenal level, we are finite beings who are not essentially free, but bound into a chain of causal determination or a nexus of cause and effect, having no autonomy and being simply thinking machines. But the question for Kant was, what do we do with this knowledge of our own finitude, our own machine-like existence? So in a manner perhaps similar to Descartes, the finite being is limited, but reason is somehow infinite because its limits are internal to itself. And these are not empirical limits. In other words, reason is theoretically infinite. It is an a priori, as Kant will say, to empirical knowledge. So recognizing the limits of reason for Kant is to be understood as the limiting of pure speculation that has no self-guiding structure. I'll read it from Kant. Because, however, human reason always strives for freedom, when it first breaks its fetters, the first use it makes of its long, inaccustomed freedom has to degenerate into a misuse and presumptuous trust of its faculties from all limitations, leading to the persuasion of the sole authority of speculative reason, which assumes nothing except what it can justify by objective grounds and dogmatic conviction. So against this derailment of a human reason that's unaccustomed to freedom, Kant saw the Enlightenment as a position or stance of critique, one that demands that we think for ourselves, even if it means thinking against ourselves, against what we naturally take to be constitutive of our very own subjectivities. Again, the second quote on the screen, thinking for oneself means seeking the supreme touchstone of truth in oneself. i.e., in one's own reason. And the maxim of always thinking for oneself is enlightenment. To make use of one's reason means no more than to ask oneself, whenever one is supposed to assume something, whether one could find it feasible to make the ground or the rule in which one assumes it into a universal principle for the use of reason. End of quote. So in a sense, the legacy of enlightenment, or what I'm suggesting to you is the radical enlightenment, can be precisely summed up best in Kant's own words. Enlightenment is the exit from self-incurred immaturity, from the inability to speak for oneself, to that of autonomous self-determination. So the word Unmündigkeit, the specific word that Kant uses, which is derived from Mund, from mouth, from mouthliness, and means that you are if you have mouthliness, that you're entitled or able to use your own mouth as you wish, meaning you're able to speak and be a full citizen, also in the legal sense, to have maturity. So in response to the question, what is enlightenment, and the increasingly pressing questions of the 18th century concerning the nature of political authority and the question of human freedom, Kant responded with a proposition for what enlightenment should or ought to be, or ought to mean, and not with a proposition for what enlightenment already is. Enlightenment, as he proposed it in the text, you will be reading, somehow points like a vector to a path of continuous intellectual pursuit, despite all obstacles, and in fact only by the recognition of them. So in a sense, Kant tells us, if I'm indeed a thinking machine, if I'm indeed some kind of automaton, then that may be my only grounds for freedom. So this emptying out, and this is a bit of a derailment, but we'll come back to Kant, this emptying out of the human person of all substantial content is precisely where the subject emerges for Kant, i.e. the transcendental subject is not a person, it is a pure subject, a doll-like thing which speaks. Think of the emergence of the Enlightenment figures of monsters, of Frankenstein, of Caspar Hauser. Is it not curious that in the moment in which Enlightenment thought, obsessed with the relationship between nature and culture, that we see the emergence of these monsters? They somehow come to embody the missing link between nature and culture. When Enlightenment sought to produce a man or woman of culture that could somehow conserve an unspoiled nature, the monster, Frankenstein, emerged. The monster emerges at the moment of emergence of the knowing subject, precisely because of the ambiguity, I suppose, between of the questions of origin, origins of language, origins of society, origins of culture. So the tragedy of the monster, who ends up excluded from nature and culture alike, but whose monstrosity is ultimately the monstrosity of culture, the noble savage, the self-educated man, turns him into a monster because society rejects him. He is not offered a social contract and ends up destroying everyone around him, including himself. So in a way, the Kantian subject, somehow, is this Frankensteinian monster. If only it could exist, then it would somehow amend the great chain of being, fill the break between matter and spirit, nature and culture. But when it does exist, when it somehow covers this gap, this irreducible gap between nature and culture, all we get is horror. Just a...
Alive! It's alive!
It's a great film. You guys should see it. Gary
it's
Wilder.
It's alive!
Okay, so... So, it's a touching horror. Huh? Frankenstein is a touching horror. There's a positive aspect in Frankenstein. He's not simply the catastrophic result of enlightenment, but the possibility somehow of another nature, a sublime nature that gets lost in the mechanical clockwork-like universe. He can only be present through the effort to somehow represent the unrepresentable, which what is lost from scientific endeavor, which Kant is insisting upon. So the uncanniness of Frankenstein, his strangeness, and other Enlightenment monsters speaks for the limits of Enlightenment and the limits of interpretation for Kant's subject, or his transcendental subject, is precisely, in his kind of critique of pure reason, a no-thing, a nothing. It is a point of, maybe we can talk about this in class, of apperceptive unity that we must presuppose in order to explain how perception can be unified into intelligible knowledge claims about the world. But this does not mean that it can itself be known like the things that it knows. It is always a subject to a gaze from elsewhere. You know, look at Frankenstein's eyes. Ultimately, also, if you know the story, Frankenstein can never really endure the image of himself in the mirror. Okay, so after, you know, and this is kind of a nicer, you know, how this the horror is not all tragic, but there's a touching horror to this Frankensteinian monster. So after this digression into monsters as the expressions of the limits of enlightenment, let's get closer a bit to the text itself. The importance of reading Kant today lies in understanding his text as an ethical and pedagogical exposition. So the question, what is enlightenment, was originally put forth by a theologian and educational reformer in 1783, for, you know, a simple questioning of the advisability of civil marriage ceremonies in Germany. And this theologian received responses in the newspapers from figures like Mendelssohn and Immanuel Kant and other figures. The debate in the newspapers was centered ultimately around how much enlightenment of the citizenry was possible or desirable and at what cost. And it lasted for over 10 years in the press. And by the time that Louis XVI was executed after the outbreak of the French Revolution, this question of enlightenment became intertwined with whether enlightenment undermined public authority and necessarily led to political turmoil. So it's important to clarify that Kant's specific form of response to the question, what is enlightenment, in 1784, was in no way posed in this reflexive manner. Kant was not simply reflecting on the question. In other words, he was not making the usual argument that is salient for us in our world, that knowledge is simply a reflexive act that simply sheds light on the world, making it more visible to sight. Rather, Kant insisted that knowing is not simply about seeing, but about speaking without fear. I remember the mouthliness, the unmouthliness that happens with a lack of enlightenment. So without self-incurred cowardice and immaturity. And this is precisely what Kant himself as a philosopher was doing, right? He was writing from his house in Königsberg outside the university, outside the academy, addressing the public in a newspaper and acting somewhat as a public intellectual himself. And by practicing this kind of public use of reason, he was positioning himself outside a close-bounded academy. And in a sense, the public use of reason that Kant talks about was in practice in the very nature and dissemination of Kant's text, to which I want to now also get more into detail in. So although enlightenment as a word bears the meaning of illumination, in the text you are reading this week, Kant does not invoke images of light. Instead, speech and discourse are the most essential elements of enlightenment for him. So what he demanded in this text was not simply a world in which everything stood naked in the light of knowledge, but one in which it was possible to speak, in which it would be possible to speak without fear. Thus, the question for Kant was about the very limits of cognition and its possibilities. What can I know, was Kant's question. In other words, knowledge for Kant does not only involve seeing, like scientific knowledge does not only involve empirical observation. Knowing is not some form of inner light either, an introspective activity. Its most important aspect is that it involves language, speaking, or discourse with and for others. Now, seeing and speaking are two very different acts in the world. Free speech for Kant, as we will see, is not in any way equivalent to the liberal idea of free individuality and expression of opinion. Free speech for Kant is not about being free to have an opinion, but about being free to use one's understanding. So this is premised on the following steps that you will see in the Critique of Judgment. One must think for oneself. The second step, one must think from the standpoint of everyone else, and one must think always consistently. So only by being proficient at the first two can we be proficient at the third. Kant claimed that we can only think freely if we think for ourselves in the company of others. And this is not a matter of formulating opinions, again, but judgments. Thus, he's not adhering to the idea of introspection as a mode of thought. Maybe an analogy that would help clarify this better. Philosophical thought was rooted in reflection before Kant's transcendental subject, and could perhaps possibly be best possibly understood in terms of the process of mirroring, so by which knowledge is understood as a secondary representation of being, and being is seen to exist somehow in itself. So although knowledge simply understood as a mirror provides the subject with an image from the perspective of another, there is still a complicity there of one's own viewpoint. You can look at yourself in the mirror any way you like. With a modern photograph, for example, this what Kant will call this parallax that's implicit in this form of reflection or mirroring becomes more pronounced because the photograph somehow has an objective nature. There you see kind of there's an uncanniness when you first look at yourself in a photograph or a mirror image, for example. This is what Kant will call a pronounced parallax in this mode of reflection. So the reflective posture for Kant is based on an optical illusion. His critical gesture is that he revealed that past and perhaps future methods of philosophical reflection were only optical delusions. Formerly, this is a quote from Kant, I viewed human common sense only from the standpoint of my own. Now I put myself into the position of another's reason outside of myself and observe my judgments together with their most secret causes from the point of view of others. It is true that the comparison of both observations results in a pronounced parallax, but it is the only means of preventing the optical delusion and of putting the concept of the power of knowledge in human nature into its true place. So what Kant is saying here is not the platitude that one should see things not only from one's own point of view, but also from the point of view of others. In fact, it is the reverse. How to face a reality exposed through a parallax, through a difference, always. So if one's subjective view is an optical delusion, then the objective perspective or the viewpoint of others cannot but be an optical delusion as well. And if the history of philosophy is nothing but the history of such reflections, then the history of philosophy is nothing but optical delusion for Kant. So this means thinking isn't simply an act from a place between two poles, but it is instead, it is the parallax between two different positions, between these different positions that acts the thinking, that thinks. So Kant too performed this kind of critical oscillation. He continuously confronted the dominant rationalism with empiricism and the dominant empiricism with rationalism. So the Kantian critique, in a sense, exists within this movement itself. The transcendental critique is not some kind of stable third position. It cannot exist without a constant transversal and transpositional movement. And why is this important? Why is critique different from reflection? Because, and this is again coming back to what is enlightenment, reflection can indeed make us aware of things in the world. You can be aware of tradition, religion, family, society, and the state, but it can never provide the grounds for a certain release from them. So for Kant, it is critique as a speech act and not as an introspective thought. That is the sole method of enlightenment. Critique as a process of questioning what is and taking a stand from it. A range of thinkers after Kant have argued that this idea of critique is simply impossible. It's impossible to step out from one's own traditions, from what are the main constitutive factors of the subject. Stepping out of one's traditions for these critics of Kant would be like stepping out of one's language and stepping out of oneself. So in a sense, what some have considered a mere impossibility, Kant posited as the very condition of enlightenment. So in a sense, can one demand the impossible is a question raised by Kant's method of critique. So the concept of critique for Kant is linked to progress, right? But progress in itself is understood as an undefined purposiveness. Even if something like progress cannot be proven, we can still discern its signs to indicate that it is possible. So this discernment of the possibility of progress does not lead to a resolute position again, but to a continuous movement of critique that is transpositional and transversal, always moving by exiting the given limits of a given situation. So what has been called Kant's transcendental critique is precisely this gesture of overturning an entire field of thinking, of not reducing the critique to either positions in a given debate, of thinking from the position of the parallax. Thus, Kant's enlightenment is not reducible to a stage of development of European civilization, but it is about the gesture of executing a critique from a place beyond the given binaries of any situation. In fact, we are compromised in reading Kant's text from the present when we reduce it to a teleology of progress. It is important, however, for us to be honest about the failure of Kant's predictions for society. Even in his own age, he recognized the lack of an age of enlightenment. So recall in the text that you will read, or look out for the text when you read these words, Kant asks, "Do we now live in an enlightened age?" And then he answers, he says, "No, but we do live in an age of enlightenment." So there must be enlightened people for the age to be called an age of enlightenment. There must be monsters, zombies, undead people for the age to be called an age of enlightenment. So even a revolution for Kant does not guarantee the true reform of ways of thinking. And I think these are quotes that are on your handout. For it can bring down aristocratic despotism or oppression, but may not be able to overcome the inclinations towards cowardice and immaturity. So again, if you go to the first sentence of the text, and I think this is one of the quotes on your handout, enlightenment is mankind's exit from self-incurred immaturity. Immaturity is the inability to make use of one's own understanding without the guidance of another. So this immaturity, Kant argues, is self-incurred not because it is a lack of understanding, but because it is caused by a lack of courage and resolution to use one's own understanding. So by claiming that this immaturity is self-incurred, Kant located the source of the problem within the self. In order to exit the state of immaturity, one must be able to carry out a process of an ethical critique of the self. One must overcome certain social restrictions, processes of individuation. The ethical has to become a process of the reconstitution of the self. So Kant says there's no excuse in saying that someone has put you in a condition of immaturity. He writes in the introductory paragraph, quote, "It is so easy to be immature," end of quote. So moving on in the text, Kant claims that it is formal academic education, the university, religion, and ideology that actively fend off maturity and make subjects fear it. So the figures of the pastor, he singles out, the scholarly book, the doctor, they're singled out as guardians who speak for the subject, as guardians who perpetuate a state of immaturity. Again, one of the quotes on your handout. I have a book that has understanding for me, a pastor who has a conscience for me, a doctor who judges my diet for me, and so forth. Surely I do not need to trouble myself. I have no need to think. If only I can pay, others will take over the tedious business for me. Those guardians who have graciously taken up the oversight of mankind take care that far greater part of mankind, including the entire fairer sex, regard the step to maturity as not only difficult, but also very dangerous, end of quote. Thus, for Kant, immaturity has come to be considered the natural state of the subject, their understanding tethered to the ruse of mechanical and instrumental logic, like domestic animals tethered to carts or guided by them. So the path of exit from immaturity is somehow only treaded at a very high cost by a mere few, almost a suicidal act. So Kant recognized that the cost of enlightenment was very high, one that not many may be willing to bear. However, he was adamant that true public enlightenment would only happen, as he says, gradually, through the gradual reforms of the ways of thinking in a society. So he argued that even the overthrow of a monarch or an absolutist state through revolution would not be enough for enlightenment, because tyrannical power somehow in society lies in the very structures of our thought. Again, a final quote, I think it's on your quotation, on your handout. A revolution may perhaps bring about the fall of an autocratic despotism and of an avaricious or overbearing oppression, but it can never bring about the true reform of a way of thinking. Rather, new prejudice will serve, like the old, as the leading strings of the thoughtless masses, end of quote. So after he makes the above argument, Kant presents us with the true factor of enlightenment. Quote, the freedom to make a public use of one's reason in all matters, end of quote. Now, this is certainly one of Kant's most famous and most misinterpreted statements, or open to various interpretations. So liberals, for one, have made it as an argument for the separation of rights and duties in the social contract. It has been interpreted as an argument about the separation of legality and morality. It has as well been interpreted as an excuse for reasserting reason over irrationality, as in the West, over other cultures. However, if we look at Kant's text closely, if we employ a close philological lens in reading this text, we would reach entirely different and contradictory conclusions. If enlightenment has to do with a reform of a way of thinking, as Kant has already stated, and not in replacements of forms of representative powers in society with others, then enlightenment does not mean the further separation of the private from the public, but an overcoming of the private, of individual inclinations, for something that is external to the self, outside it, foreign from it even. So nothing is required for Kant for enlightenment besides freedom. He tells us the freedom to make public use of one's reason in all matters. Social and political institutions do not cease to command the subject to obey. Kant lists the state, the church, the Prussian king, they all command one to obey, and indeed one can obey. But in order to be free, the subject must undertake an act that shifts them from the particular conditions of their subjugation to a universal realm of reason. So again, the public use of reason does not simply oppose the individual to their particular surrounding community, but opposes all particular communal institutional belongings against a universal exercise of reason. So the task of the public use of reason for Kant was not to answer questions and solve problems, but to redefine the very grounds of problems, to ask about the horizon of meaning, which is always already there structuring our approach to reality and of which we are unaware. I think I should stop because I had more, but I stop now, so Courtney will take over the next section of it. Yeah.
So good afternoon. Thank you, Nadia, for that lecture. Perhaps my lecture, you'll find that maybe my lecture should have come before hers, but for some reason it isn't. So what I'm going to try to do in the remaining time is introduce you a little bit to the block of texts that we're reading and focus on two of the other texts, aside from Kant's What is Enlightenment? Because these blocks, as you know, part of the design of this course is that the blocks and the readings within the blocks will create a kind of discussion around a central issue. And of course, the central issue of this block is enlightenment. And there is no concept, I think Nadia has gestured towards this, there's no concept that is more difficult to understand and for which there are as many different answers as the question, what is enlightenment? And it's very important to see that in the period itself, there was constantly this discussion, right? Kant wrote an essay called What is Enlightenment in answer to the question that was posed to the public. And if you read the answers, the many answers that people wrote to that particular question, they are completely different. They range from dismissing the idea of enlightenment altogether as a kind of foolish question, as something that should be written on scrap paper and thrown away, to, you know, Kant's particular answer to other answers. And I'm going to try to give a snapshot of both some of the differences between that we'll see in the text that we're reading in this block, and then I'm going to move and talk mostly about the last of the three texts, which is by a critic of the Enlightenment, but also an Enlightenment thinker named Herder. So I'm going to talk a bit about our three figures there, Kant, Condorcet, and Herder. So just a word, we've heard a lot about Kant, but I just want to focus on a particular aspect of his notion of enlightenment. And I'm going to paint it fairly negatively because I want to do so that you can see what, for instance, Herder later will be pointing towards when he's criticizing Kant for the abstractness of his conception of enlightenment and whatnot. So here's just a quote, actually, from the Critique of the Power of Judgment. This is in your reading. Kant writes, let me have mine here. However, by the name of common sense, so first of all, in this passage, Kant is explaining a notion of common sense, that we have a kind of common sense, and this is central to what it is to be enlightened, is to exercise such common sense, right? He says, however, by the name of common sense is to be understood the idea of a public sense, that is, a critical faculty which in its reflective act takes account a priori, right? Now, by a priori, Kant means without actual reference to empirical things. So when he says takes others into account, he doesn't mean we ask them questions. He means we a priori can take into account what another person would think. We take into account a priori the mode of representation of everyone else. So we take into account what everyone else thinks in our judgments, but not what they actually empirically think, but what they should think as a third person, in order, as it were, to weigh its judgment with the collective reason of mankind, the collective a priori pure reason of mankind. And thereby, we can avoid the illusion arising from subjective and personal conditions, which could really be taken for objective, an illusion that would exert a prejudicial influence upon its judgment. Now, what I want to point to there is, first of all, there's a contrast, as you've seen, between taking the a priori collective standpoint of human reason and taking the standpoint of one's particular self, or of indeed anything empirical or historical, so it's not just my own personal things that I should not take into account, it's your personal things as well. I should take you into account only as a representative of human reason and try to give this weigh all of my own judgments against this model of an abstract a priori reason. So Kant tells us in several texts to cultivate the capacity to distance ourselves from everything particular, individual and personal, and to think from the purely abstract third person standpoint of the collective reason of mankind in this passage. For him, we are most active, we are most autonomous, we are most ourselves, we are most free, and we are most genuinely thinking for ourselves when we do precisely this, when we take this third-person standpoint. And when we think for ourselves, we presumably think just like everyone else should. And this is a very characteristic move that someone like Kant or Descartes, you saw this in Descartes, this move they make, the idea is we should retreat into ourselves in a certain sense, right? We should find our genuine self. But in that passage into ourselves, we have to give up everything particular. And so somehow, by this, seems like a trick, by retreating into ourselves in the genuine way, according to the right method, we will discover in ourselves exactly what is in everyone else. And there will be a kind of general agreement reached in this way, right? So, by abstracting from ourselves, but still moving into ourselves and taking charge of ourselves, we will somehow reach complete agreement with what others would think in our circumstance. So we will see that Herder attacks this idea of Kant's and similar ideas in Descartes as an utter fantasy. So that's just one snapshot of Kant's text. Now, Condorcet, the second block of readings, or the second set of readings for this block, the second reading, is called A Sketch for a Historical Picture of the Progress of the Human Mind, written in 1795. In this book, what Condorcet is attempting to do is to tell the story of the development of modern European culture from its earliest times, and he divides this into a number of eras. In your reading, you have eras 8, 9, and 10. And in era 8, he talks about kind of the gradual discovery of modern European thought, particularly the emergence from prejudice of reason, from prejudice, during the times of Columbus and Luther and others. And he retells the story to show how through it the kind of embracing conception of reason and of technology and the developments of science were coming about. In the 10th era, he deals with his own period and summarizes all the many changes that have taken place in society, science, culture, philosophy, the arts, in his own period as a result of this release of reason from prejudice and superstition. And in the 10th era, he projects a kind of future, idealistic future of mankind. He says that just like Newton's laws allow us to predict the orbits, perhaps the historian of human nature should be able to, with some degree of certainty, predict the future developments of mankind, right? Now, in this text, which you will read, Enlightenment is equated not with a kind of third-person standpoint or anything of that nature, but rather with a kind of freedom, a very, very common sense notion, a freedom from authority, freedom from religion, which is often equated with superstition in the text, with slavery, and with most of all, stupidity, ignorance, and prejudice. So such freedom is achieved by the application of what he refers to over and again as reason, by which Condorcet means the kind of unprejudiced, self-reliant, and scientific use of the mind as described in the works of Bacon, Galileo, and Descartes. So he's simply taking up that notion of reason and of reason, the scientific use of reason that we've seen developed in earlier writers, and showing how through its development culture has been transformed, and that is what he calls enlightenment. Now, this leads to a particularly Eurocentric conception of what enlightenment is, right? And here's one quote to give you a kind of a sense of what Condorcet means. He says, for instance, aren't all nations bound someday to approach the state of civilization reached by the peoples who are the most enlightened, most free, most clear of prejudices? For example, the French and the Anglo-Americans. The chasm separating these peoples from the slavery of countries subjected to kings, the barbarity of African tribes, and the ignorance of savages, mustn't it gradually vanish in the progress of mankind? So he's talking about the future, and in the 10th era, he thinks that all kinds of negative things will vanish in the world. All nations will become like modern European civilization, particularly like the French. And this is inevitable. This is what science will bring. I'm going to skip to the next set of quotes, and then I'll come back. Here's another quote from Condorcet. He says, so time will come when the sun shines only on men who are free and acknowledge no master except their reason, when tyrants, slaves, and priests and their stupid or hypocritical instruments will exist only in history books or on the stage, when we'll give no thought to them except pitying their victims and dupes, and keeping watch for any new sprouting seeds of superstition and tyranny, so that if they dare reappear, we can recognize them and stamp them down by the weight of reason. Right? So reason will, for Condorcet, inevitably lead to, he says, the equality between the sexes, to equality in education for everyone, to equality in wealth for everyone, to a time when people will live indefinitely long periods, when language will be perfected, knowledge will be available to all, when nations will all be equal, when war will end, when sciences will be perfected, and when human beings will all be morally good. Right? This is the prospect he builds for himself. And he ends the text that we read with a reference to the philosopher who sees all of this coming and who will live in this time. This is a quote at the bottom of this page. He refers to this philosopher as contemplating an Elysium which his reason will have created for him. This is a wonderfully ambiguous text, because the Elysium, of course, is a picture of Elysium. It's mentioned in Homer. It's an ancient conception of a kind of ideal heavenly place. And Condorcet is referring to an Elysium that reason will have created for us. Now, the ambiguity there, Condorcet doesn't mean it ambiguously. He means that reason really will create such an Elysium. That's what the philosopher understands, right? Now, for Herder or someone, he will see in that reason creating the kind of fantasy of such an Elysium. That's the kind of ambiguity, right? Reason creating here. Do you mean reason creating, we create in our mind such an Elysium? No. Condorcet means reason through history will actually create such an Elysium, or at least approach it indefinitely in the future, right? So that is a kind of negative snapshot of Kant and Condorcet in a way, or at least their conceptions of enlightenment. And you can see that Condorcet's notion of enlightenment and the Elysium to which it will lead has some very interesting presuppositions, these that could be discussed. In particular, it presupposes that a kind of scientific reasoning is also necessarily humanizing. He seems to think that through the progress and dissemination of knowledge and science, people will become better, right? That simply by the improvement of our faculties, we'll become morally better people. That the knowledge means getting rid of prejudice, and getting rid of prejudice means treating others equally, and that there's a natural progression from knowledge and scientific knowledge to better conduct of human beings. That's one of his presuppositions. He presupposes that technology and equal access genuinely will guarantee equality of condition. So he thinks, if you read, there's a passage on wealth, and he thinks that simply through the development of the economy, wealth will necessarily become more equal. That seems very unlikely from what we've seen in the history of the world since Condorcet. So there's this very questionable that simply by technological advancement and dissemination of knowledge and technology, that things will become more equal. Now, clearly he's right in some respect that things become more equal. The internet has made people more equal in a lot of ways and that they can gain more access. But does it actually lead to, by itself, equality of condition? That's the question. Or could it equally lead to even greater disproportions in things like wealth or condition, if not supplemented in some way? So another presupposition is that the improvement of our instruments, our tools, our language, our mathematics, and so on, and of our minds and bodies will turn us into better, morally better human beings. Now, if we turn now to bring these two together to try to contrast Kant and Condorcet somewhat, and I put these in colors because they fit together, we can see kind of in a very caricature kind of way, but still in a way that has some foundation, that for Kant, enlightenment is brought about through a cultivation of our rational and impartial judgment, thus through a kind of transformation of ourselves, our inner selves. Such a transformation should take place primarily for Kant, so he's not interested so much in political revolution, or he says nothing about technology. Right? Nothing about the development of science in his What is Enlightenment text. Right? It's all about changing how one's mode of thought, and from that, opening up and protecting a public space for discussion, and society will follow that. Right? So transform oneself and everything will follow. This is broadly a very Cartesian kind of idea. Right? The way to transform science is to transform the way you think, and then everything deductively follows from that. It's the same kind of movement. Now for Condorcet, enlightenment is brought about through a transformation of the social conditions and the advancement of knowledge and technology. That is his main emphasis. Moral progress or transformation of the mind should follow and spread as a result of this. So that's one contrast. Another contrast is that for Kant, enlightenment is not about possessing instruments or even about possession of knowledge, but about using one's own reason. Kant says nothing about gaining knowledge. He's not interested in encyclopedias and the dissemination of knowledge as part of enlightenment. That's something else. You can be enlightened and know nothing, because enlightenment is a standpoint that one takes. Whereas for Condorcet, enlightenment consists precisely in knowledge, in freedom from superstition, which means knowledge of the truth. Right? So technology, advancements in disseminating knowledge, knowing things, being a physicist, knowing modern physics, that makes you more enlightened than others, right? Now, the third contrast is that for Kant, superstition and prejudice are bad because they are passive uses of our reason, right? Not active uses of our mind. They are heteronymous, he calls them, not autonomous. They're not exercises of our own reason. But for Condorcet, prejudices are bad because they are false, because they block the progress of history, not because of any issue of the passivity or autonomy. That's another issue. Okay, so that's a kind of snapshot difference. Now, I turn to, we didn't time this quite well. I want to say just a few things about this last text by Herder. Now, what you will see, there are several texts, one called This to a History of a Philosophy of History from 1774, and you will, interestingly, although it's written 20 years before Condorcet's text, you'll see in it a great difference and a kind of lampooning of this kind of story of the evolution of European society towards an Elysium. And I will turn to illustrate that to one quote. Let me see if I have it here. Here you go. Now, this is written 20 years before the text by Condorcet, but you can see from it immediately what Herder is, how he's going to emphasize and think about this. So Herder, too, is an Enlightenment thinker. He says in one of the quotes, which I don't have time to read, that he embraces the Enlightenment, but rather he wants to offer observations and a historically accurate assessment of the Enlightenment and comparison of the Enlightenment with other things, rather than a kind of eulogy, he says, of it. And here is what he says. Those who have so far undertaken to unfold the progress of the centuries, for the most part, have in the process the pet idea, progress to more virtue and happiness of the individual human being. People have then, for this purpose, exaggerated or made up facts, understated or suppressed contrary facts, hidden whole science, taken words for deeds, taken enlightenment for happiness, taken more subtler ideas for virtue, meaning taken more scientific knowledge for morally good things. And in this way, people have made up whole novels about the universally progressing improvement of the world, novels that no one believes, at least not the pupil of history and of the human heart. And so you can see in Herder, he sees himself as a historian who wants to give an authentic assessment of this estimation of both Kantian abstract judgment, this third-person judgment. He criticizes this because of its abstractness, its emptiness, its weakness. He claims, unlike Kant thinks that when you think for yourself and take this abstract standpoint, that you are avoiding the mechanization of modern culture, that you are taking up autonomy, whereas Herder thinks that exactly what science does, and you can ask yourself this, whether this is true, is it relieves us, modern science and the dissemination of knowledge relieves us of the need to think for ourselves. So Herder sees in kind of the Kantian standpoint and in Condorcet's kind of praise of the evolution of modern culture, a continuous weakening of the human being, gives us an ability to rely on specialists, physicists, doctors, encyclopedias. We don't have to know the things because it's all there in the encyclopedia. So it relieves us of the need to actually look into what other people think, into the matter for ourselves. And it allows us, you can think of Kant, it allows us to rely on our a priori, meaning non-experience-based conception of what reason is, rather than the historical, maybe Baconian investigation of the truth. Unfortunately, we're out of time. Thank you.